next coming up is a topic: how is technology shaping the future of streaming? We have stalwarts from the streaming platforms, technology giants, of course, coming forward to speak on the topic. After which, we also have a celebrity panel where we will talk about how OTT has it democratized creativity and stardom. And post which, we will have the dynamics and diversity of OTT content. So lots of good information coming your way. Stay tuned with us. Coming up next, we have, like I've mentioned, how is technology shaping the future of streaming, panel discussion here. And stalwarts of the industry joining us on this panel are Mr. Lokesh Chauhan, Chief Technology Officer, Eros Now; Sid Mantri, Senior Vice President, Product, MX Player; Rohit Tikmani, Head of Product and Growth, Viacom 18 Digital Ventures; Mr. Pankaj Kedia, Managing Director, Emerging Markets, Dolby Laboratories. And chairing this session is Aditi Olman, Co-Founder and Head of Marketing, Mylane Foundry. A very warm welcome to all of you. I request all our panelists and our session chair to please switch on their camera and mics and join us on screen. Eagerly waiting to hear from all of you on this very pertinent topic that our viewers will definitely take some key takeaways from. Once again, a very warm welcome and thank you for joining us this afternoon. Aditi, I'd leave the screen to you.
Thank you very much, Kathy, and thanks for the warm introduction. I hope I am audible.
Yes.
Okay, great. So thank you very much. We have an amazing panel here today and I'm really looking forward to this session. Definitely technology is the most exciting topic to discuss about today, not just in OTT, but in all streams where we are seeing how the pandemic today is accelerating the adoption of technology across industries, across verticals, but video streaming is specifically very, very exciting because all of us live and breathe content, video, and it's an essential part of our lives. But while we talk about this growth story, we talk about the next 500 million that is now coming onto OTT platforms. We're talking about tier two, tier three growth and the stellar growth overall that we are seeing in OTTs. It's also important to talk about what are those challenges that each one of you are facing while enabling this growth into tier two, tier three, and even rural India. And how are you going about tackling those challenges? I think I would like to start with Rohit to get your views on what are those challenges, how are you tackling them, and what do you see as for challenges even going forward as rural India also comes on board into the OTT bandwagon?
Different parts of our business have different challenges in our journey into the hinterland. For the subscription part of our business, access to banking is an issue, basically enabling rural users to make payments. For the advertising part of our business, the usual connectivity latency challenges abound. In general, the prices of smartphones are still out of reach of the next billion users, so to speak. We've been hearing of promises of 2,000 rupees smartphones and 3,000 rupees smartphones for a long time now, but they really don't cut ice. It's a decent OTT experience can be only had on a 4,000, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 rupee device still. So yeah, typically these three would be the top challenges: access to payments, digital payments, access to high quality networks, and access to high quality devices.
Great, thanks, Rohit. And you talk about digital payments. Do you also see a lot more partnerships happening on that space to enable better, smoother transition into digital payments? Or do you see other kinds of solutions such as actually, relying more on cash cards? I do know that there are a few regional OTTs that have sort of looked at actually using cash vouchers for users in areas where digital payments is a difficulty. What do you see as that trend happening in the digital payment space?
I think telco partnerships are the path of least resistance. Is the path of least resistance cash? We haven't really explored. We've been seeing cash cards in India for the last 15, 20 years, but never really thought about it that much, to be honest.
Thanks, Rohit. Sid, would love to hear your views. Of course, MX player, primarily being an AVOD player, has been doing phenomenal in terms of watch time and getting viewers to actually come back to the platform. But what are those challenges that you are facing for scale?
I was about to say, we kind of solved the payments and access to banking problem by making our content free. So I think for us, the biggest problem has been cost of data and data connectivity and data penetration. It's a big focus area for us. I think a lot of our customers, especially tier two, tier three cities, they tend to live on a daily plan of, you know, 1 GB or 2 GB data. And they tend to burn it out. Like, we've had so many instances where, you know, users want to consume our content, but literally run out of their quota of the data that they have on a daily basis. So that's one. I think, again, telco partnerships is one way to go about it. Clearly, we live in a country where net neutrality has to be respected. And so we've got to find creative ways. I think the second challenge I'll talk about is, as we start, you know, getting deep into tier two, tier three India, the preference and the taste of content is very different. And there are regional preferences. You know, there's a very, very strong, you know, preference for region-specific content, language-specific content. And being able to cater to the diversity of preference that, you know, users have, and then being able to target it, and that's where kind of product and technology kicks in. Being able to identify those tastes and preferences, and being able to, number one, generate supply from a diversity point of view, and matching that supply to the appropriate demand. I think that's where we focus a lot of energy, our energy on.
Great. Interesting. And talking about localization, there's a lot of effort going in by multiple players. Lokesh, I did read that sometime back. You've also partnered with Google Cloud for AI subtitling for regional languages also. So would love to hear from you. How do you perceive, you know, overall the challenge of tier two, tier three, but also localization in particular?
Thanks for the question, Aditi. And let me first start answering the larger question, the problems that we are facing. The biggest problem, and all, I think I speak for most of my colleagues, is the ability to deliver content. The pipes are still small. The tier two, tier three connectivity is still a problem. It's only we can cater to a certain percentage of people who clearly have a line of sight with the network. That's it. Rest of it is still awaiting. So a large part of India is still awaiting options of offline delivery and cash payments, which kind of requirement. Right now, we're looking at a niche where people are aware of how to do things online, and we're only serving that crowd. We need to get out to the masses and say, you know, this is available for you also. So that is where I believe the larger part of the problem solving has to happen. And it would be a very strategic option of working with the telcos, working with the government, we're working with partners on cash collection side. We have to do everything, and the whole ecosystem needs to evolve. I would say that is where the larger part of the problem is. Obviously, localization, as you mentioned, we are trying to do our best. We're trying to ensure that content localization from both subtitling and speech perspective starts happening more and more. And we don't believe going the human way is the right method now. Since we are a global service, we have to cover all geographies, and it's physically not possible to getting all those renditions and all those stuff. So that's where we are saying we will utilize technology. We're looking at partnering with multiple players just to identify which suits our need best in what markets.
Thanks, Lokesh. Absolutely. And while we are all trying to solve the problem of last mile and making sure that content can get delivered and even payments can happen for the tier two, tier threes, it's probably also important to look at, in the middle of all this, how, you know, what is the quality of experience that the user is getting? Because while, you know, we are looking to scale, we are also looking to retain customers and make sure that they come back to the platform. And in our company also, we are looking at how can we help enhance that experience. Pankaj, Dolby is trying to do something similar by actually looking at how can you leverage the power of the edge device, of the consumer device, to get certain experiences while maintaining continuity of video delivery and audio delivery. So we'd love to hear your perspective and your view into this problem.
And from our perspective, it's not a question of this versus that. It's not an or problem, it's an and problem. So while we have to scale, reach new consumers, I think how do you engage and retain the existing consumer, as you said? I mean, how can you whether monetize them better or engage them better, longer view times, increase engagement, all of that. Audio video quality has proven many a times again and again that it helps engage, increase engagement, whether it is increased view time or, a better brand connection and many other factors. And at Dolby, we're in the business of enabling spectacular experiences, both for audio and video. And we do that by working across the entire ecosystem with content creators, with the content distributors, like we have our colleagues on this panel, and also with device manufacturers. And what we see on the device side is there has been a significant ramp up on device capabilities, both on the audio video side, and not just at the premium, $1,000, $2,000, TVs and phones, but even on the $100, $150, so in Indian currency, 10,000, 12,000, those price points, both on the television and on the phone side. So the capabilities on the devices is constantly increasing. We did a pretty significant global survey, including in India, last year in the middle of the pandemic. And what we found out is that over 90% of the respondents had recently upgraded or were planning to upgrade the device in the next 6 months. So device refresh is also happening very fast now. But what is being delivered to the devices a lot of times is not optimum to what the device is capable of. So one is there's a missed opportunity, and there is obviously there's a mismatch in the expectation. So I think it is a mindset issue. Sure, there are challenges. Having been in this industry, having worked with many parts of the industry, including in cinema. I remember an interesting incident, an instance where when we were engaging with Bollywood, creators, there were 10 years ago, the mindset, the reference was this, dilapidated cinema in the middle of nowhere in a village, and with broken speakers. So let's create content that how people can hear there, that. But on the other hand, there was the cinema right down the road, which was state of the art. And so the references were all wrong. So we made that shift. We worked with them to shift that, mindset from trying to create with first, content with broken speakers rather than, hey, create content for the best possible. But yes, let's make sure it works in the other side also. So I think this is not an or question to me. This is an and question. And I think service providers need to factor in more about device capabilities and leverage more. I think it's at the minimum, this is a missed opportunity.
Right. Thanks, Pankaj. That's a very unique but important view that we cannot think of it as an either or. It has to be and. Because we spoke about it earlier as well, while there is a need to make sure content delivery happens across the board, the viewers are also getting more and more demanding, right? Pankaj and I were discussing how today, on our small screen, we get Hollywood content and we also get Indian content, region content on the same screen, on the same platform. So the demand of a certain quality, both from a content standpoint, but also from a quality of experience standpoint is really, really high. And so it's important to look at both of these together. Now, while we talk about all of these, while we want it to be an and answer, there's always this optimization issue that exists today, right? Because of the last mile challenge. But do you see, and I would love to hear from each one of you, your view on this. I mean, what we get to know now is that 5G is that panacea. 5G is going to solve everything, right? 5G is going to bridge all those gaps that exist. It's going to bring in virtual reality streaming. And I don't know if... our dogs will start dancing in augmented reality using 5G. But jokes apart, I would love to hear from the actual horse's mouth what is your expectation in the medium term, but also in the long term from 5G? Do you see it solve all of your problems? Do you see new forms of streaming emerging, or do you, or are you a little more skeptical about all that, you know, picture that is being painted? I'll actually start with Lokesh because I can see him smiling, and I'm sure he has an opinion on that.
I have got the both pros and cons of 5G in my head. Like, I definitely would want self-driving cars where people don't have to do anything except for watch content on the VR set. So I should be happy about, you know, 5G coming in and everything's been so great. Immersive experience, interactive experience all across. But then I have to take a step back and understand what 5G is doing in developed markets, because we also serve developed markets. And there we understand the line of sight aspect of 5G is becoming more and more important, and India might not be the best use case with that. The high concentration of city centers in India actually are far and few, whereas a large part of India resides in a very, what you would say, far away from 5G antenna scenarios. And the way 4G rollout has happened and how it has changed things, we agree to it, but the incremental change that 5G is going to bring, is it actually going to be there, is a bigger question. I personally am trying from our side that we are as ready from immersive experience perspective for 5G enabled content delivery scenarios. But it seems like it's going to take a few more years. At least from an Indian perspective, it is going to take a longer period for it to become big enough to create the impact. And I would be judicious with the dollars that I have to spend and not go all out preparing for 5G onslaught.
Right, right. Absolutely. So basically, be optimistic, but also, you know, think practically as to what is the impact that you can create in the medium term. Rohit, what are your thoughts? I mean, do you see, for example, 4K becoming a reality in the in India in the next few years because of 5G or other advancements in the infrastructure?
4K will become a reality, 5G or no 5G. I really don't know about 5G. I ask myself, what can we do with 5G that we can't do with 4G? How better than 4G is 5G? Will people notice even? So we don't have a top-down thesis-driven approach to technology. Like, we don't predict the future sitting in some room saying 5G will change the world and then start acting on it. We have a bottoms-up approach, and we pick technologies that help us get to our goals and help our customers get to theirs. So I really don't know about 5G. It could very well be just faster 4G, in which case, depending on how fast it is and whether that speed will be even discernible by end user, may or may not matter to the OTT business.
True. And there's also, basically the point that 5G might just be a lot more useful for industrial use cases, industrial IoT versus actually, you know, for consumers. But Sid, I would want to hear your view, and especially from the point of view that, MX Player also has Takatak, which is sort of the short form video content platform, and which is, fueling, I think, the next generation of video consumption. So how do you see not just 5G, but, newer infrastructure, how do you see that supporting the short form video, revolution, if I may put it that way? I think you're on mute, Sid.
Sorry about that. My son just walked into my room, so I muted. It's a really good question. You know, one of the reasons why I'm excited about waking up in the morning and do what I do is because a perk we enjoy is we kind of get to live and invent the future in so many ways. So I think the bigger problem is really data consumption quotas or data consumption capacity and the cost, like I said earlier. I think 5G will help in terms of enrich the quality of video that users get to watch for the same amount of data consumption. But we've kind of solved the challenges we have today when it comes to speed and data, because we're the first OTT in the world who's commercially launched H.266. That's cutting down size of video as well as bandwidth requirements to about 50%. Those savings go all the way to 70% when you go into HD content, 720p, 1080p content. So I think 5G will help enhance the user experience, because for the same amount of data consumed, the users will be in a position to get significantly better quality of content as we also push the boundaries of the codecs that we use, along with the speed efficiency that 5G brings in. I think the second part is, you mentioned 4K content. I think 4K content is a bit of a urban phenomenon in India right now, and I don't expect that to change, because the devices and the equipment or the infrastructure you need to consume 4K content, needs to get cheaper and more accessible. And it remains to be seen whether the pace at which mobile consumption of content is growing, when that plateaus versus the pace at which that 4K capable television that costs significantly more and not everyone can afford it. And in addition to the fact that the television becomes a very constraining consumption experience, because it's not personal enough. I think where we find the strongest growth is where entertainment is very personal and is completely at your discretion. Television, access to television tends to be a communal experience, and it's not at your own individual discretion. So it remains to be seen whether that kind of kicks off in a big way. I think we're probably some time away from that happening. But the mobile consumption kind of going at breakneck speed and will continue going at breakneck speed, because it's a very, very personalized experience, not just the technology, but even the access to entertainment every user has.
Absolutely. And, a very valid point that it's not, while the 4K living room is an urban, exciting but urban phenomenon, mobile consumption is just growing at a breakneck pace and will continue to do so. And Pankaj, would love to hear your views on that, because from Dolby's end, you are trying to really create experiences now, not just in living room, but also on mobile. How do you see this playing out with newer infrastructure coming in? What is your view on 5G or on infrastructure being developed better? We did speak about it, and you mentioned that you do believe that a lot of current problems will be solved, but would love to hear your views on the same.
I think two parts to that answer. So I'm pretty bullish in 5G. Luckily in Singapore, they've rolled out 5G. I get to, I get over 300 Mbps on my phone on 5G. So it's pretty amazing. It kind of equals what I get at home with, the fiber connection at home. So it's very, to me, 5G, yes, will enable some new use cases, whether it's VR or AR, but, how mainstream they will be, I think needs to be seen. We need to see how the consumer adoption is going to be. But I do think, being wireless, it will have advantage for markets like India. India, has always done well with wireless connectivity. And I think there, in terms of solving our existing challenges of content delivery in a robust, reliable, and high-speed manner, I think there's going to be a lot of advantages that's going to come with that. One thing we have to also remember is 5G is very evolving right now. There are, services being rolled out, but there's a lot of work happening on the innovation, the evolution of 5G. So it's not at a point where we say, this is 5G and this is what's going to get rolled out. There are standards being written today. There are new use cases being developed for 5G. There is experimentation happening on, broadcast type linear delivery over 5G, which can, go mass, So you don't have to send one stream to a million streams of the same thing to a million people. You can do broadcasting type linear distribution, which works on phones and, other places. I think 5G, yes, in terms of the wireless access, does it really open up opportunities in the home? I think, yes, it is an exciting possibility there, because we obviously know the broadband penetration is limited right now. So can that open up? So I think that's on the 5G. I'm pretty bullish, but I'm more bullish on our existing challenges getting solved and, around content delivery and experiencing getting resolved. And I'm sure there are going to be new use cases, but I think one needs to watch and see what. There's been a lot of excitement about 3D and VR, but they haven't really become mainstream so far. So that needs to be seen. I think the comment on the screen, what we have, you know, seen over the years, and you know, we've done this for a long time, is what we have seen consumers usually would choose the largest screen that they have access to. Now, it's possible that a young kid, you know, may not have access to the TV screen in the home. That's totally possible. But when they have access to a certain screen, they will usually choose a larger screen. Now, it used to be the cinema. It used to be the living room. Now, people don't have access to the cinema. We've seen during the pandemic, the growth on home consumption on television has really increased significantly. And it's not really been at the cost of mobile. It's been in addition to mobile. So in that sense, you know, I'm much more bullish on the living room and the large screen. And I mean, if you just look at a market like India, the price point you're getting 4K televisions at is very mainstream now. It compares to, you know, what we spend on phones or even sometimes lower than that.
Right. Absolutely. And I think, again, it's an and answer there, because it also depends on the kind of content. For example, for short form content, like, you know, what we have in Takatak and other platforms, the format is such that people really enjoy watching it on a smaller screen where there's a lot more interactivity in sort of watching the content versus, let's say, if it's a more immersive kind of content like a movie. I mean, I'm talking from personal experience, right? I would like to watch a movie on a large screen, but if it's short form content, which also, by the way, is growing really, really fast. We had done a survey internally at our company, Mylan Foundry. We did a survey with 1,000 people, and almost 30% actually claim that they on a daily basis actually watch short form content, which is less than 2 minute content, on a daily basis, right? As the primary form of content. So definitely, it is I think it is going to be both ways. I think living room is definitely will be growing, and the pandemic is accelerating that because people are spending a lot more time at home. But short form content also from an interactive standpoint will be fueled by the mobile phone and the, you know, audience that is sort of always having access to their mobile wherever they are, right? I mean, people take a break from work and then they watch a couple of videos on these platforms also. Great insights and very, very inspiring. I can see there's a question as well for Rohit. From somebody in the audience, what are the investment plans for content delivery, user experience, and security that you have at Viacom, Rohit?
Wow, that's a big question. Content delivery, user experience, and security. That's
pretty much covers everything, I think.
Everything. Investments, we make investments, like I said, in a bottoms up. I assume you mean investments in technology. So like I said, we have a bottoms-up approach. Technology is a means to an end. And wherever there is a need to help our customers get to their goals or our business to get to ours, we don't hesitate to invest in technology in all those three areas and more.
Great. Thanks, Rohit. I hope the question was answered. I don't have the person's name who had asked the question, but thanks for the question. I also just generally, you know, I'm sure everybody in the audience is curious to know, while we're talking about so many different key priority topics, we would love to know, you know, for each one of you as a product and technology leader, you know, when you wake up in the morning and you're thinking about work, what are those three priority things that you have that you're, you know, either firefighting or innovating on? Those top three things that come to your mind. Lokesh, would like to start with you.
Sab chal raha hai kya? That's the first thing that you kick in the morning. Any random alerts that you have missed because you have put your phone on silent to get a sound sleep is definitely there. That's typically the start of the day. But then things move along. So there's a BAU aspect. You just check on things of what is the progress of things that is already going on and outgoing, releases and roadmap and this and that. But then the other priorities obviously is innovation. You have to understand the way things are evolving, how markets are moving, how certain breakthroughs are happening on a regular basis, and see, does that use case apply to this industry? Does that make sense to invest in any of those, what you would say, innovations, either building it, licensing it, or co-building it? Either of those situations, we have to have our eyes and ears completely open all the time for hearing news around anything to do with video, at least. And anything beyond video is obviously there.
Right, right. And when you talk about innovation, what is the time frame that you look for outcomes? Because obviously, from industry to industry, it's very different. But for OTT, what is that turnaround time that you look for, outcome from investments in innovation?
So typically a quarter out, a lot of things typically take at least a month long effort to build in-house or with vendor partners. And then you have a typical cycle of releasing on beta for internal QA consumption and seeing. So typically for most features that we envision now can go out or innovations that we should invest now and see a possible release cycle, it's a quarter out.
Okay, interesting. Sid, what about you? What's the usual day like in terms of your priorities at MX?
It's a great question. I tend to think about it in terms of what is it that gets me excited, get out of bed in the morning, or what is it that I go to bed with thinking about, can't wait to get up the next morning and continue, these things that I have to put a pause to just because the body's going to get rest. I think there are three things I wake up with that are always top of my head. First one is getting a pulse of the customer. And so, we cannot do a daily report on, what the App Store ratings are saying. We measure NPS at a very regular basis and going through those reports. And so getting a pulse of the customer, we do fairly frequent user research studies. And so all the different channels through which we get to, listen to customers, observe how they use a product. That's number one. Number two is how we create differentiation and value for our customers. And, technology is a means to achieving that end. So how do we push the boundaries of technology with the skill set and the tools available to us and create differentiation and keep widening that differentiation in terms of value we accrue to customers. We think about customers in three dimensions. And I think of all these three as my customers, the end users, the content creators, whether it is, publishers who are creating content on Takatak, user-generated content, or whether it's studios producing premium content. And the third one is the business itself and how we monetize the business. The business is actually my customer as well. So that's number two, how we differentiate. And the third one is, as a leader, how we elevate and upskill the people that I work with, the people who work in my team. And the one thing that I kind of stress on, because I feel all of the problems take care of themselves, is if we push our limits on taking pride in our craft. And so pride in craftsmanship is kind of the most important right up there when it comes to how I help my team succeed and raise the bar.
Thanks. That's really inspiring, Sid. I hope you do get enough sleep after so much that you're handling.
Being in Singapore and being 2.5 hours ahead, it's going to be very challenging it's almost when I go to bed is when it's peak activity in India.
Right. At least thank God you're not in the US. Otherwise, it'll be totally lopsided.
Crazy, yeah.
Yes. Pankaj, you're also in Singapore. I hope you get some sleep too after all the work that you're doing. But I know that you're handling emerging markets and there's a lot of things that you're doing. Would love to hear about your priorities, about what you do on in a usual day.
Yeah, I don't do well if I don't get 8 hours of sleep. So I get my sleep. Very important. But yeah, I think important priorities. Number one is people, especially right now, especially with the teams, and what's going on across the world, especially in India. So that's really top of mind. But expanding on that people piece, in better times, really thinking about, how can we enable our teams? How can I enable my team to do the best work? How can we enable customers externally, whether it's the creative or it's a technician, or it's, you know, it's a manufacturer. How do we enable them? So enablement is a big thing on my mind, and what's the role I can play personally there. And the second piece is around, you know, customers. You know, how can we serve our customers better? And Sid talked about it. You know, I think, you know, whether it is bringing more value to their businesses, helping them meet their objectives, you know, what is that we can do for our customers? How can we be better partners? And I think the third piece is around connecting dots, because we are in a very unique position that we work with a very large cross-section of customers. I mean, it's a tall statement, but we pretty much work with everybody in the industry, from everybody who makes every device, from everybody who makes, who distributes every piece of content, and people who create that content. So we are working with a very large cross-section of the industry. And, you know, and we have people who have deep relationships in each of those areas. And I think we bring some unique value in trying to be able to connect those dots together. So I think those three.
Great. It's really great to hear that, you know, technology and customer are two of the things that is common across the board, and which rightfully should be, because OTT is highly, highly dependent on technology in terms of actually the you know, the infrastructure itself and the ability to actually deliver certain experiences, but also the customer being in the center of everything. Rohit, you've been an entrepreneur, and you're currently the head of product and growth. I'm sure you bring in an entrepreneurial spirit into what you're handling right now. What's your day like? What do you focus on?
Well, every day is different, but there are a bunch of things that always play on my mind. Mostly, let's say, from an outside-in perspective, the quant metrics for our viewers, advertisers, our business, from a qual stuff, keeping a finger on the pulse of the sector, on the consumer. This is like a, you continuously pay, you know, partial attention to these things. But the thing that these days especially, I'm spending most time on is inside-out stuff like team happiness and their growth and alignment with stakeholders, especially in this remote work from home situation, how the culture shaping up, things like that, really. So yeah, outside in, inside out. And regarding the entrepreneurial part, when I was an entrepreneur, I did my job professionally. As a professional, I bring entrepreneurial spirit to the work. So it's really doesn't matter who owns the shares of the company. You've got to do a job and do a good job of delivering value to your users, investors, partners, everyone.
Absolutely. Great. Thanks so much. I know we have about 5 minutes to 6 minutes to go, but I do have, because this is a panel talking about technology trends. We did talk a lot about the challenges, about how we are trying to overcome them. We talked about 5G, but I would love to know from each one of you, what is that one trend that's super exciting to you personally, and you really would put your money behind it? Pankaj, I'd start with you. What do you think is that trend that you're already seeing happening, and how has the pandemic impacted that, you know, in terms of acceleration, or has it slowed it down? Would love to hear from you.
And I think, as we've spoken, I mean, the pandemic has accelerated things. I mean, and then the obvious thing what we spoke about, there's increased consumption, there are better devices, you know, better engagement. But I think talking about the one trend that I'm personally very excited about is actually audio, because there has never been more interest in audio than there is right now. I mean, if you look at Clubhouse, you look at podcasting, you look at music, it's just never been more important. And, you know, I mean, just the people that are getting behind it, the quality of content that's coming out. You know, we are working with a very interesting company in India. They're a startup. It's called Earshot. It's a podcast service, and they do scripted drama on podcast. And it's just stunning content. And the fun thing is that they're doing it in vernacular languages like Bhojpuri and Assamese, very different from, you know, the typical urban type of, you know, content creator that we would kind of usually work with. So it's very interesting. And I think the whole audio space is very exciting, and it's just the start of where things are right now. So I'm very excited about audio itself. I mean, it's strange that we come back the full circle and go back to audio, but I mean, I think there's a lot of excitement around audio right now.
Absolutely. It's just exciting how audio has picked up. It's always been an immersive form of content, I would say. It's just not been explored to the extent audio video together has been. But now you can see with you know, so many podcasts going viral and millions of followers, it's definitely, you know, a great trend, and it's only going to keep growing. Thanks, Pankaj. That's very interesting. Lokesh, what about you? What is that one thing that, one trend that you'd put your money behind?
Actually, that's more like working with Dolby.
Awesome.
The immersive experiences that we constantly believe are going to be the real talking point of consumer experience. The large screen with immersive audio or HDR content in itself, that is where the world is headed. I mean, obviously, as Sid and you both talked about that, you know, the 4Ks of the use cases are very urban right now, but investment in content creation has to happen now so that you have a sensible enough library 3 to 4 years down the line.
Right.
So investing in creating the right library, investing in a pipeline to ensure the content essentially is available with those bindings now itself is something that we are very excited with. And we are going to constantly push towards newer standards. We're constantly working with partners specifically to ensure that we are not left behind the curve, and later we are just trying to find how do I upscale audio, how do I upscale video, and kind of do a catch-up. This is not the time to, you know, wait and then see what happens. This is happening. People are going to buy new TVs. People are going to buy new amazing sound bars and surround systems. And if you are not providing the content which is enjoyable in that, probably going to remain a mobile-only player in a tier 2 market.
Right, absolutely. That's a great point. I think, you know, the devices world is always, you know, running very fast, faster than the rest of the world. It's, I think, important for the content world to also catch up and be able to provide those experiences that the devices are capable of, whether it's our mobile phones or our televisions, all kinds of devices that we're watching on. Great point, Lokesh. Rohit, would love to hear from you as well. What's your personal favorite in terms of, you know, a trend that you're seeing has caught up recently and you think would really accelerate going forward?
Sure, there are a few, but if I were to put my money on one, it would be on synthetic media, synthetic audio, synthetic video. I think we are at the top of the current S-curve. There's only so much time shifting, place shifting of existing filmed entertainment you can do. I think the next S-curve starts with synthetic media. So, yeah.
Very exciting. Absolutely. Sid, my personal favorite in terms of trend is actually interactive video. And I know MX Player has dabbled with that as well with RightClick. But I would want to know what's your... what is that one trend that you see happening and you are very excited about?
You just stole my answer, Aditi. we're very excited about interactive video. But if I can generalize that, I think from a trend point of view, you know, one thing I'm going to call out is what the pandemic has done, especially in India, is it has created digital literacy for a very different segment of users, you know, like the 40 to 60 year old segment, like my dad and my mom, who would typically depend on me for all of their technology needs. The pandemic has forced them to learn it all by myself, or to learn it all by themselves. My mom did her first digital banking transfer a couple of days back, because although it was available to her for so many years and we were pestering her to do it, she would insist on physically stepping out and getting it done. Maybe it was her way of getting some exercise or whatever, but she didn't have a choice now. And so that lack of choice has catapulted and accelerated digital literacy in a segment of users that wouldn't have never happened if not for the pandemic. But I think from a, you know, going back to the other answer, the other part of the answer, I think entertainment, especially video-led entertainment, has for the longest time just not changed. It's always been like two-dimensional. Maybe, you know, there's attempts to make it three-dimensional, but it's still very passive consumption. So interactive flavors of video, whether it is, you know, the interactive video, which was not linear in its storyline that we launched on MX, you know, a couple of months back, or whether it is short-form video that tends to be a lot more interactive, the user is clearly commenting, liking, following a publisher. You know, we've enabled P2P chat, and we have, you know, communities and conversations happening in the context of short form video. I think that interactive element and social element to consuming content and transitioning users from passive consumption to active consumption, I think that's the one I'm really excited about, because it has untapped potential. We hardly scratched the surface.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sid. Very interesting. I'm glad you were able to get your mother to use digital banking. It's still a nightmare for me to get my dad to do that. So very happy that that's happened. And thank you very much, all panel members. I think we've reached 45 minutes and it's been so engaging. I just didn't realize time has passed. Thank you for getting together. I think I had a lot of fun discussing with you, and I hope to continue these discussions offline as well. Over to you, Kathy.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you
very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much to all our panelists for your time and insights here. Thank you, Aditi, for steering this very interesting conversation at E4M Play Second Edition.